night instead of home in front of the television set. And there are days when I wonder that myself. But it comes for... In thinking about that again, and I do that each time, I went back to a class in college in my senior year where I darn near flunked a counseling class. It was the only counseling class I had in college and seminary. And it was in Rogerian theory, where you reflect back everything the other person said, you just repeat accurately, and that was the one technique they taught. In my book, there are 30 of them, but that one you're supposed to repeat back. But I somehow had missed the message that what you do is you repeat back what they say and you let them figure out where they are. I still thought, like I find most people think, that when we're listening, we're supposed to help the other person. We're supposed to give them advice. We're supposed to solve their problems, fix things up for them, you know, and that's what we're supposed to do. Well, the professor presented a problem where she had the problem and I was supposed to counsel her. The problem she presented was one I had in a relationship I was in right then. And I didn't have a clue what to do with it. But what I did was jumped right inside myself and thought, gee, what, you know, I mean, I don't know how to solve this myself. How can I help this other person solve it? I got all lost in me, darn near flunked. It took me a long time to learn not to do that, to really focus on the other person, because it's what we learn. I can't tell you how many times I've worked with people where they're learning how to counsel or listen, and the first thing they do is to try to solve your problem. You know, instead of treating me as though I could solve mine and helping me do that. So that's a process, and we're going to come back to that every now and then through the evening. And I've got some exercises where we'll practice a little bit and give you a chance to catch those voices in your heads that immediately want to solve or fix the other person. Because I've become convinced that unless I recognize those, I'm going to use them. But somehow I have to recognize them, bite my tongue really hard, and not use them. And then do something totally different from what makes any sense at all. And we're going to work on what that is. We've talked a little bit about the fact that some of you have already picked up books. 50 years ago, when I started in my first church out at the coast of Oregon, I started counseling right away because that's what pastors do. People come in to see them. And what I found out was that as soon as, if I saw them the next week, if they were worse, I was worse. If they were better, I was just relieved. Then if they came the next week and they were worse, I was worse. There was something wrong with this. I just didn't have a clue what to do. Fortunately, there was a minister in a neighboring church who was a really good counselor. And I went and spent time with him and started learning. And he invited me to sit in on group therapy he was doing with women who were on aid to dependent children care with the welfare program. One of the women in his church was a welfare worker, and the two of them together worked with folks because they figured out they needed more than money. Paychecks just didn't solve their problems. They needed to be able to sort their lives out and make better decisions than they had been. So I sat in with a year with him, and before the session we would talk over what was going on in the group, how we might approach it, and then afterwards we'd review it. And so after a year I was getting the hang of it. And then the caseworker asked if I would go with her to another neighboring town. This was Astoria and then Seaside. So I spent a year working with her with a group she put together there. So that was my introduction. It's where I really got to learn. Then I moved to the Portland area, and I've been taking workshops and classes ever since. And got to the place where I was doing lots of group therapy and doing a lot of teaching about personal growth and all of this stuff. I hit a place 35 years ago or so where I said to myself, you know, I've really got enough material in this to put a book together. But then I looked in the mirror and I says, you know, you fella, you are the guy who never in your life has written a paper before the last night before it was due. Not once. You are a reluctant writer from here to eternity. You know, so What I realized was I needed some pressure on me in order to actually do that. So I signed up for a doctoral program with a seminary I'd gone to, and the salespeople with the seminary were quite agreeable to my writing that book as my doctoral dissertation. Those were the salespeople. Later on, when it came time to get my dissertation topic approved, they said, "Oh no, you've already developed that material. You have to do new work." Anyway, there's 200 pages of new work that included testing on people that read book chapters and that took the classes before and after, all that sort of thing, and lots of research, and about 125 pages that were the first part of what's in the book now. And that was sort of the project. The other was the research phase of it. And the book project had titles for chapters were all this long. And the research project had titles for the chapters that were all two lines long, you know, with lots of big words. You know, and so anyway, but what I knew was that if I signed up for that program, paid all that money, told everybody I knew I was going for a Doctor of Ministry program, I would be too embarrassed not to finish it. So I just stuck it to me with my own internal stuff and realized I couldn't face people if I didn't finish what I said I was going to do. So I got the thing written. Great technique. If you want to get yourself to do something, just remember when the John Birch Society, that ultra-right wing operation, you know, I used to say to people, if you want to get something done, if you want to lose 10 pounds, it's really easy. Just write a letter of appreciation to the John Birch Society. Put a check for $100 in there and say, you can use my name in your advertising. And give it to a friend and say, if I haven't lost 10 pounds in a month, send this. You know, I'd die first. You know? See, there are ways to get things out of you. But that's kind of on the side. In any case, I went on from that, after I finished that was 30 years ago. Come in, there are seats, there are a couple right down here in front. A couple more over here.
Yeah, so,
yeah. It's all right. I wrote a little bit more on the talker listener card process, which we'll get to in a little bit, so for people that took classes, and it did that in two or three phases. Then when I was going to retire in 99, just before I did, my wife said to me, Sally, she said, Jim, I'm going to write a book. She had developed material and workshops on starting and running a one-person business and had been doing those. She says, I've got this book. I think I need to just go ahead and get that written. And that was 3 months before I retired. So she read a book called The Artist's Way that helps you think who you are and figure out if you're a writer, an artist, or whatever, and gets you moving in that direction. And so she was going to do that three-month program, and it would finish right when I retired. And I said, well, I'll tell you what, you do that, and at the end of that time, when I retire, I'll walk out of my office, walk into the kitchen, and I'll take over. And then you can go in to write your book. I'll handle the kids and the shopping and the cooking and the clean, all of that stuff. It'll be a relief from what I've been doing. You go in there and write your book. So she did. But I watched how hard that was and how difficult it is to actually get that whole process done. And I thought to myself, I'm not going to do that. Well, after about 2 years of retirement, I finally got rested enough and thought, you know, I'm going to do it anyway. And I got a contact from a university in Virginia and a seminary, and they wanted some of my communication material. So I put that together for them, and we did about three versions of that. And then finally, by the first of 2007, I'd actually finished the book and produced it. And that's one of the hardest things I ever did in my life, and it was one of the most fun things I ever did, was to try to take what was in here and put it on paper. So that's over here, and the price for here is $10, which is down from $18.95. If you happen to know somebody that wants to start and run a business, doesn't want bosses or employees, we have a few copies of Sally's book there, the Dream Book, that's for them, to kind of a workbook to help them figure that out and do it. And she just the last few weeks passed me up, because now she has two books out, and I put one of another of hers there called Tea Pie and Some Other Things, which are short essays that are quite interesting. So anyway, those are all sitting there. And over there on the table also, if you happen to know somebody who needs to look for work, this is a really tough time. Southminster Presbyterian up the street has a class coming up in the next week or so for folks who need to rethink that whole process and how you get work. And Pam Gross is had run Career Makers for years and years and years. We'll be doing that, and there's some brochures or some sheets there that describe when that happens. And that'd be a good thing to hook up with. And also, if you would like to get our newsletter, there's a place to sign up for that. Whew. Now that that's done, let's get to work. Okay. Listening, counseling, for me, essentially the same thing. If I listen well to you, I help you sort out what's going on in your life. You figure it out and say, this is what I'm going to do. You get that figured out. Because you calm down, you relax, you think straighter. If I listen well to you. If I try to tell you what to do, you get all blocked and you get irritated and want to throw something at me. But if I listen, it allows you to work it through and sort it out, and you get to feeling better. You know, what I do lots of marriage counseling still, and I can't tell you how many wives want to kill their husbands, because the husbands just know from the male guidebook for marriage that they're supposed to fix their wives' problems. They are absolutely responsible. And it comes from when we lived in caves, you know, centuries and centuries ago. And a guy had to, you know, fight off the other tribes and the lions and tigers and all that stuff and keep the old lady safe. It was his job. Well, nowadays, that which is comparable is solving her problems. And so she starts to talk, and the guy starts to fix, and she wants to belt him one. And you might think that's a male-female thing, but it is not at all, because many women have a certain mothering tendency which has them absolutely believe that somehow it's their job to fix the problems of this guy who is like one of their kids. You know, and so when he wants to talk about what's going on in his life, she wants to fix it and be helpful. See, the trouble is, and particularly it's a real problem for Christians, we all want to be helpful. The problem is, most of us just don't know beans about how to do that in relationships. And what we try to do is fix people's problems, and what that does is it puts them down and makes them feel inadequate. You know, I've been doing counseling for 50 years now. When somebody starts in, you know, 9.5 out of 10 times, I think, that's number 32. Or I've heard this one about 812 times. And I have a pretty good idea what the answer is. But the answer is that if I give it to them, it doesn't work. See, if I try to fix them, it doesn't work. They get resistant. Also, if I give them a solution, which might actually be the correct one, if they go out and put it to work, do you know how much energy goes into it? 1/3 energy. Because it's my solution, not theirs. They walk out kind of stooped over thinking, boy, he's sure smart. He knows how to manage my life. And I'm sure dumb because I don't. Boy, does that help them. See, it just doesn't set them up to function well. It just doesn't. If I help them sort it out and they come up with it, they walk out straight up and feeling good and ready to take it on. If they took my solution, when they come back the next week and it didn't work, guess whose personal responsibility that is? Mine. If what they did that I told them to do, which was right, but they didn't try very hard, if it did work, guess who gets the credit? I do. That doesn't help them. See, we're going to work on listening method that helps the other person grow and come alive. In seminary, one of the most meaningful and very few things I learned about counseling was a theological piece, and that was that a counseling session is like structured agape. See, the word for God's love, God's accepting love, agape, that surrounds us and supports us. If we do listening well to people, it's like organizing God's love around them so they can relax, feel safe, begin to think better, sort out their lives, and make better decisions. For me, that is what allows me to do counseling, because I down deep believe that when I'm in that situation, I'm not alone. That God is working to help this other person come alive. And I might be the instrument of God's activity doing that. So I would just encourage you to think about, when you're listening, just think, God is here helping out. You know, this is God organizing love around someone, and we're kind of helping that process. So we're going to start now by looking at how a person operates when they're functioning well. I put the emotional system there. That's kind of round, smooth edges. You know, that's the personal part of us. That's where I get frustrated, irritated, excited, angry, concerned, worried, all those kind of feelings we have. I like to put those here, and I put them here because when I'm going to speak in front of a group, that's where I get the butterflies. If I get hungry, see, something down here gets moving, and I think, where's the refrigerator? You know, or is it lunchtime yet? See, that feeling or sensation jolts my brain, gets me thinking. And those are energies. Like getting the dissertation done was fear of embarrassment. Strong feeling down here jolts the brain. Sit down with your butt by the computer and get to work. You know, get to it. So these I also see as God's given. Some people want to think there's some good ones, some bad ones. Like hates bad, loves good. Well, sometimes mother love will restrict a child growing up so they don't hardly learn how to walk across the street by themselves. And sometimes when we hate, we can actually lift a car off of a child. See, they're all energy. The question isn't which ones we have, it's how we use them. See, there's actually a biblical phrase. Paul said something about the gifts of the Spirit. The question was, are they used in love? See, by an action that is helpful. That was Saul of Tarsus. May of West, one of my favorite American philosophers, said at one point, it ain't what you got, baby, it's what you do with it. See, that's the way I like to think about emotions. It isn't which one you have, it's whether you act on it in a way that is helpful and that builds and, you know, that does good stuff, or is what we have there stuff that does bad stuff. It isn't different because of what's in there, it's what we do with it. So I see these as involuntary. Okay. Then the next part I put in would be the brain. That's where I think. That's the part of me that processes, that remembers and plans and all of that stuff. That's the part that notices when I'm curious. So I'm curious, the brain says, oh, Google it. You know, go find out. See, and a way to think about behavior is that it's moving from the state of anxiety to the state of rest. I go from being worried about something to trying to solve the problem. I go from being hungry to eating something. Now, sometimes we have too much weight is because we go about from being anxious about something to eating where it wasn't really hunger. If we just ate when we're hungry, we wouldn't be overweight. It's when we're hungry and anxious and worried, and we think that's hunger, and so we go try to throw stuff in there and glob that up so it doesn't feel so bad down there. And that kind of works for me as a way to think about that. Notice this has harsh edges. See, thoughts by themselves are not friendly. See, we are a group of people in this room. That's not a friendly statement, because you don't know, am I happy that we're here in this room? Am I wishing I could be home watching the news hour? You know, or a tennis match? See, you don't know. It's the emotional part that lets you know the personal stuff. It's this part here that lets you know, am I happy to be here? Do I enjoy what I do? Do I want to spend time with you folks? Am I interested in what's going on in your lives? See, that's this part down here. This part up here is pretty logical, you know, and not like that. This stuff up here, what comes out of there, I like to think of as head talk. That's when we describe our thinking. And head talk is debatable. Like, this is the correct way to load a dishwasher. I've had couples ready to kill each other over that issue. See? You know? See, that's a thought. That's an idea. And it's debatable. If I say, I don't like to load the dishwasher, non-debatable. See, I don't like carrots. You can't argue that. Carrots are good for you. We can argue that. See, a lot of people agree about it, but it's debatable. Okay? See, so stomach talk. Stomach talk is non-debatable. Stomach talk begins with an I usually. See, I'm upset, I'm frustrated, I'm irritated. Notice how those only took one word. I'm frustrated. If you get poetic, you say, I feel anxious, a little slippery like a duck or the water sliding off a duck's back. See, that's sort of poetic, so it takes a few more words. Most emotions just take a word or two. When you're first trying to express feelings, people will often say, I feel that. Now watch that. I feel that you're stupid. See, that's not a feeling. See, that's a thought. See, when somebody says, I feel that, you shouldn't have done that. That's an idea. That's the judge talking to you. See, those are not feelings. When it takes more words, the I feel that, it really was not a good idea for us to gather in this room because of this, that, you know. See, that's rational stuff. It's different to say, you know, I'm glad we're here. I like this room. It's expandable and comfortable. See, those are feelings. You can say feelings in very short spaces. When you start to go into a bunch of words, you're rationalizing, making up a lot of reasons, and that's what sets you up for argument and debate. Okay? Now, there's one more part here, and this is a yin-yang squiggle. You know, it takes two to tango, that sort of thing. And I put that inside a heart. Because that's the part of me that recognizes that I have something to offer and that you do. I figure I've got some things to share that can enrich your life. And if I pay attention, I can learn from you folks and stuff in your lives that could enrich my life. So the heart part for me is part ownership. See, it's recognizing that, you know, some people will say, well, people say that piece of art is thus and so. See, that's not heart talk. Heart talk is, it looks to me as though that is thus and so. See, that owns it. It acknowledges this is my point of view. When people come to you and say, you know, people are saying about you, you don't know what they're thinking about you. See, heart talk takes ownership of what you think and feel yourself and acknowledges that. That's easier for people to hear. Also, heart talk leaves room for the other person. If I say there is only one way to load a dishwasher, there is no room for you. If I say it looks to me as though the best way to load it is this way, that leaves room for you. See, you might see a different way to load it. See, heart talk acknowledges ownership and that I have thoughts and feelings and is open to yours. Now, one of my favorite illustrations about this is the television preaching, or some of it. The ones who say, the Bible says! See, and right away, the hair in the back of my neck stands up, because rarely do I agree with what the Bible says from the guy or gal who is talking about it that way. See, usually the way they see it is different than the way I see it. Usually it is. I'd be a lot happier if they said, I feel really strongly about how I understand the Bible to be speaking to us. That would leave room for me to have my point of view, and I'd feel a whole lot better. See, those characters that do that kind of leave out heart talk. And heart talk is openness and ownership. Now, for me, if you put these on a balance scale, incidentally, my degree from college is in mathematics. Isn't that a great background for a minister? but this is, you know, I learned this in science, okay? Okay, we take the stomach talk and put it here and call that an E for emotion. Take the heart talk, put that here for H for what I think of as the human factor. that balances this thought here, which I think of as J or judgment, for the thought we have. If you want to say something to someone, write a letter to somebody, and have a chance of it communicating, you need all three parts. You need what you're concerned about, that this is how you see it, and they may see it differently, and then what you actually think about it. See, all three of those. What normally happens is, when we need to say something, we decide to be nice, and so we kind of lock up a little bit, and we say something like, don't you think it would be helpful to our kid if you got started on your homework now? All I communicated was the thought. When you do that, what happens is the balance, see, these things fell off, the scale tipped, went down to there, and this judgment became judgmental, and you got in the game of courtroom. And the kid right away says, no, I don't think so. There's television to watch. I've got texting to do, you know. There are all sorts of things that are more important. See, we all think we're helping the kid move in the direction, you know, don't you think it's time you got to bed now and got some rest? Well, of course he doesn't. See, we didn't say it straight. See, straight would have been something like, I'm worried about your health, kid. You may not like it. Time for bed. See, that's straight up clear. See, that's the message that communicates. See, all three of those need to be in there. Now watch that. See, I said all three need to be in there for it to communicate. That's debatable. I think all three of them need to be in there. And I'm excited about the possibility of doing it that way because I found it works. See, that lets you know what's inside me. That's easier to hear than if I just say, this is the way it is. See, the this is the way it is people, oh. One of my favorite, I did a wedding on the beach one time at the coast for a couple that were, then they were older than I was. They were probably in their 60s somewhere. That was a long time ago. Sally was the one witness and the photographer, and our kid Vicky, who was 11 at the time, was the other witness and the sandcastle builder. And so we did the wedding on the beach. And they were talking about second marriages and what it was like getting together in old age, sort of. And Sue says, you know, Galen has his truth in the kitchen. And I have my truth in the kitchen. And they're not the same truths. See, the recognition that we see things differently. It's what allowed them to make it together. Because they could value both points of view. Put them together and mix them up and see what they got. They weren't one trying to beat the other one up to get them to load the dishwasher correctly. All right. So this is how I see a person operating, and that's when it's kind of all working. Let me talk now about what happens when a person gets out of whack. When someone comes to you with a problem, they don't look like this. They look like what this picture will look in a minute. So you take this emotional system here, and you start out when we're little kids, we get frustrated about things, and we never quite get it out of our system, so we leave a little bit in there. And then something else happens, and somebody else gets an A, and we didn't. We were trying to saw a board, and it was getting screwed up, and the father did it well, and we kind of felt small and insecure. And we end up with a lot of leftover stuff from when we're little kids down here in the emotional system. So there isn't really a lot of operating room in our emotional systems. Then as we hit junior high age, you know, the person we fall in love with doesn't fall in love with us, and we have this ball of rejection that stays in there. Now, as we talk about, we let some of it out, but a bunch of it stays in there. So there's this residue from the past. And you could kind of go in your life and figure out what those are. Then we live in a kind of a permanent crisis. Just take the economic situation right now. And so we're worried and anxious about retirement and all those sorts of things. And we're upset about job losses, you know, and that's kind of here. And then, of course, there's the H1N1 that we might get and get really sick. So we're worried about that. And you know, that's not fitting in the container. See, it has to begin to expand to hold that stuff. And then we have some crisis on the job or in our family, and we get a big load of anxiety and upset, and then we get angry about something. And then we look at the healthcare situation in the Congress, you know, which I would like to pitch into some ocean somewhere. And in my system, that takes up about this space right here, you know, irritation, anger, frustration. And so the body has to adjust because the emotional system expands like this and kind of overloads. So then the body kind of reshapes itself a little bit. Women who've been pregnant understand this. You know, when you've got this load in here, you know, you just, somebody comes up to be friendly, you know, and it's uncomfortable. See, what happens is, see, here a wife or a mother, for example, is worried about the kid who's sick, and the husband comes up to be, hey, honey, you know, like that. And it, the ribs pinch on all of that emotional stuff that's squeezed in between the ribs, pinches on them, and they hurt and get anxious and say, how can you think of sex at a time like this? See, it's just, you know, the body just goes out of whack. Now, notice the heart function here. There's not room for it. See, so what happens is that the heart function sort of flattens out and becomes brick-like. So, and those are our relating functions. See, that's the part where I recognize I have a point of view and I'm open to yours, you know, and if we talk things over, we can work things out. See, that ability goes away and it's either knuckle under or kill them. See, we just see like two options. We don't say, no, wait a minute, there are a whole series of possibilities here. We could, let's just knock it around and see what we can come up with that might work. See, we can't do that when we get emotionally overloaded like this. See, think when you get stressed, something happens like that, the body just gets out of whack. Now, if you think of that body, see, expanding here, it's pushing everything out of place towards the back area here, in the spinal area, it's pushing up, putting pressure on, and what happens is that it begins to flatten the brain against the top of the skull. It puts pressure like this. See, so the brain kind of goes like that, fills in, and just think of that brain. Think of that malleable brain, and just think of you go like that, it squishes in all directions. Equal and opposite, or something like that. I learned that in college, I think. See? And think what happens when that does that. First off, you've got these memory banks in there. You know, so if you need to take a time test and you got to answer quick, you know, all that stuff you knew yesterday, see, it was in there when you went in to take the test. You looked at the questions and you got anxious. Emotional system went wham like this, brain went flat. The memory banks, those little chips in there, they twist. You know, and you can't access them. See, it's just like when your hard drive kind of goes to pieces on you. But then when you, after the test, and you go out and you have a cup of coffee with your friends, you think, all that stuff comes back. Or if you're standing in front of a crowd, this used to get me in church, I'd have to introduce people up in front of the church. This is my friend Wally, we've fished together for 20 years. He has a last name, you know, it's just, see, like this, a little anxiety, a little nervousness, brain flat. See, just not there. It's gone. Calm down. It drops out of the back of the brain onto the back of the tongue, and it's there. It takes that relaxing to do that. You know, if you're under pressure, if the cop or somebody, you know, asks you for the license, the number on your driver's license, you know, it's just gone. Now notice also, see, think of that pressure squishing in all directions. There are the eyeballs right there. So it puts pressure on the eyeballs. So I look at a person when they're angry with me, you know, and the eyes are bulging. See? And we say to a kid comes home who's 9, 10, 11 years old, upset because the teacher tore up his paper in the class. You know, he's all upset. And what do parents do? See, they look at those glazed eyes, the bulging eyes, and they think, this kid needs a lecture. See, this kid needs to understand that teachers sometimes have bad days. You know, that, and actually, I want to know, what is it you did that caused this? See, this, or you try to explain things to the kid, you know, eyes bulging, nothing penetrates. All the kid can see is that you're against him. That's all. You know, and it's really clear. And he's right. Okay. Now, friends look like enemies when we're anxious and worried down here. Then we see a friend and they look like an enemy. They're out to get us. Notice, too, think of that expanding brain. Look, there's the ears right there on that fault line. And so if you walk into a meeting and you're late, You're anxious and a little worried. Somebody says, "Hi, how are you?" What you hear is, "You're late again, stupid." See, we do not hear accurately when we're upset. Just think if we're down here depressed. The thoughts up here are all negative. Life is no good. There's not a chance in the world. I have no friends. I'm all alone. See, that's the kind of talk that comes out of an emotionally depressed, flat brain. If I'm really angry, you know, it's like this, you know, calling you names, all of that stuff. I might say, you know, "You're the worst person I ever knew in my life." Okay. Now later on, when my brain unflattens and I calm down, then I think, oh, that wasn't true. I can think of, oh, half a dozen worse. You know, your perspective comes back when you calm down and you can see straight again and think straight. My favorite illustration of this is the young couple that comes in to me to get married. And they have absolutely different backgrounds. You know, different religions. One is outdoor active, the other is inside reader. One was from a higher economic situation, the other a lower. And just, you know, you just go through the list, and their chances of making it a marriage are 1 out of 72. You know, they're so different. And so I said, and their parent styles for handling conflict. I mean, one set's Italian, you know. Yell and scream and then hug each other. And the other one, there was never a word in public around the kids. Now, once in a great while, every 3 years, there would be a little sound come from the bedroom where somebody had raised the voice just a little bit, but that was it. See, so debating, discussing, arguing just didn't happen publicly. So this person has no clue how to do that. So you get these two together. And so I say, how are you going to handle the differences of opinion and the conflicts in your relationship? "Oh, no problem. We're in love. We're in love." And I look at them in their eyes. They're bulged like that. You know? Now, what does that mean? Well, first off, they've got that load of stuff from childhood. Then they've got the fact they're irritated with their parents who've told them this will never work. You know, they've got all that in there. And then their friends have said, "You got to be kidding. You know, you're too young to get married." See, and they're resistant. And then they are infatuated. They are all turned on, you know, whatever word you want to use for that, you know, all sexually passionate. And not to mention that down in here is a whole section where they're scared absolutely to death that if they lose this one, they'll never find another one. See, so they've got this whole load in there. Brain is flat, they're not thinking. See, nothing is working, eyes aren't working, ears aren't working. Now, is that the time for me to give them a lecture on conflict resolution? On listening skills? See? No, doesn't work. Not useful. Okay. And I noticed something too. And I noticed that there's a lot of room for the mouth. See, when you push that all out of the way, you know? See, when a person's all upset like this, they tend to talk more. Now, 1 out of 10 people talk less when they're upset, but most people talk more when they're upset. The trouble is that what you're hearing is coming from a flat brain, from a defective brain. Now, let me illustrate that. You know, when I'm really angry, you know, and I say that thing about you being the worst person in the world, "You're the worst kid I've ever known in my life. I don't know why I put up with you." Okay. Later, I come back and I say, "You know, honey, I know I said awful stuff, but I really didn't mean it. Does he believe me?" No. Why? It was a congruent message. You know, the body, you know, the words, the tone, it all went together. It was congruent. So if you have said something awful to somebody, or if you were passionately in love and you said, you know, "I'll climb the highest mountain, swim the deepest sea," you know, but "Can't come over tonight, I can't get the car," you know, something wrong with that. See, if you really blow it and say something awful to somebody, do not go back and lie to them and say you didn't mean it, because you did. See, you meant it when you had a flat brain. So what do? You go back and you say, I want to talk to you about what that awful stuff I said to you. You know, it was really bad. And I want you to know that I was emotionally overloaded, all uptight. My brain went completely flat. I was crazy, and the stuff I said came out of a nut's brain. You know, and I apologize for doing damage to you because I know that was hurtful. See, I did mean it then. Now that I'm calm, I don't mean it. See, here's what I mean now. See, those are different. That's understandable. And I think it's understandable because that's how it works. See, it's pretty simple. We all at times lose it. And for me, it's helpful. Rick talked about forgiveness. It's helpful with forgiveness for me to realize that there are times when I get emotionally overloaded and get flat-brained and make crappy decisions and do hurtful stuff. Because I do that, that gives me the understanding of why you might do that to me or somebody else.
Is there any value in consistency?
Say more about that.
Well, you know, I can imagine people often having flat brains, and wouldn't it be fair at some point to say, gee, could you stop having a flat brain? Could you be consistent? Instead of always being sorry, could you just be more consistent and not be a flat brain?
You'd sure like it that way, wouldn't you? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. If you, we'd all like if all of our friends didn't get like this.
Well, include yourself.
I mean, yeah. Yeah. I'd like it if I didn't get that way. What I find is that not getting that way doesn't seem to be a really good option. What I also find though is that when I understand this stuff, I have some chance to moderate it. So I don't get as flat-brained now as I used to. I rarely get angry, but it's because I've learned to deal with my upsets and frustrations early on rather than to let them build. See, there are things we can learn to do, but what I'm here to teach is that when somebody around us gets really flat-brained, that's when we need to go into listening mode and do something that will help them do several things. And that question raises the question about what can we do with old flat brain here? Okay. First thing is we want to reduce the emotional overload. And I do that by helping them to describe it. Say, my gosh, you seem really upset with me, you know, or really angry with the world or something. So they can go, yeah. And it's like steam in a pressure cooker. When they go, yeah, a little of it comes out and they're less angry or less upset than they were. So first step is to help them reduce the emotional buildup, and we do that essentially by helping the person name that. It helps sometimes to use numbers, like how angry, give me a 0 to 10 scale about how angry you are. 14, 19, whatever. Okay. As soon as they've said that, they've dropped 2 points. See, it's like lets it out. Literally, when I'm working with somebody who's depressed or angry in the office, and I say, it sounds like you're just fried with your husband. They say, oh, God, yeah, I really am. They go, see, some of it comes out. That's one of the functions of good listening, is to help people describe it, get it out, see, not be put down for having it. See, if I say, you shouldn't be flat-brained and fat-bellied, does not help. That puts more pressure on. If I say, oh, you are flat-brained and fat-bellied, they go, yeah, and let a little bit of it go, that starts to help. Second thing is clarify the thinking. So we're going to clarify what's up here, and they're related. So I say, so you're really angry here. What are you angry about? Oh, this happened. Uh-huh, you expected that, and what happened was this. You felt down here let down. Oh yeah. Was that disappointment? Frustration? What? I was mostly disappointed, a little frustrated. Okay. And you got that way. What did you do then? We moved back to here. This movement between brain and stomach, between head and stomach, is one of the rhythms I want you to pick up when you're working at listening. And sometimes when I'm dealing with somebody who is depressed, angry, whatever it happens to be, I just look at their body and I just think head, stomach, and I'm just moving back and forth. If they talk about the head, oh, what my husband did was this, and then he did that, and then he did that. It gets worse. So wait a minute, back two of them back when he did that. How did that hit you? Oh, I got really worried. So we got to get into that emotion for a little bit, and then what happened? Oh, then you go back to here. If you move them back and forth, that's where therapy takes place. That's where they start to get healthier because the emotional stuff is starting to come out through the mouth into the air, and the brain, the thinking is starting to clear up. Okay, so that's two of the four goals in listening or counseling. The next two have to do with the heart function in here. And one of them is to help them sense that they have a friend and that they're not alone. You know, the fact that I do not judge them or put them down or tell them they shouldn't be the way they are, you know, any of that, that allows them to relax and feel like they've got a friend. I work sometimes with people who are really depressed, and they're saying things like, see, out of this flat brain, I do not have a friend in the world, nobody cares about me, nobody spends any time with me, nobody listens to me. Now, this is after 15 hours of my listening to this person. What do you think my natural thought is? What? How can you say that, you idiot? You know, 15 hours I put into you. You know? Would that help?
No.
Probably not. Good assessment. Good assessment. Okay.
Well, but it lets them know that, I mean, that you mean business.
No, it wouldn't. No, then they would walk out, see, more convinced that nobody cared about them if I did that. See, the problem would have been that I would have been talking instead of listening. Now watch this. Then when they say, I have no friends, nobody cares about me, I'm all alone, I say, my God, that must feel just awful. Oh, it really does. How does it feel to feel that alone? Oh, like I'm hanging on the edge of a life raft and can't hold any longer, and there's nobody there to grab me. So you feel like you're going under. Oh, yeah. And then we walk through, back to the head, what's got you this way? See, what's disappointed you so much? They talk about the relationships, and we go back to the hurts, and we move back and forth, and after a while, when they calm down and think straighter because they've been heard, they say, you know, I really appreciate that you listen to me and you're my friend. It's one of those things, if you have to tell them it doesn't work, what you want to do is listen long enough until they tell you what you know to be the truth. Take a kid that comes in with the paper, you know, or just had a fight with Johnny next door, comes running in, all angry and upset, and you want to say, okay, let's go over and talk to the parents. Say, gee, what happened? Oh, he threw a rock at me. And we want to say, and did you throw a rock at him first? You know, I mean, see, we know the kid. But instead of that, we say, oh, that must have scared you. Oh, it did, yeah. Did he hit you? No, didn't. Just missed. Whew. Uh-huh. What happened before that? And so we get him to talk about it, and finally we acknowledge and say, yeah, I feel really frustrated to have trouble like that with Johnny because you guys are such good friends. Oh, yeah. Then he heads back out to play with Johnny. See? We don't need to tell people the stuff they need to figure out themselves. They'll figure it out when their brains are working, and their brains will be working when we listen to them long enough and get that to work. Okay. So anyway, that second piece in there, or third piece, was provide a friendship so that they know they're not alone. And the other piece is to help build confidence in them. And you build confidence in a person you're listening to by not telling them what to do. If I tell you what to do, that diminishes you. That says, you're stupid, I'm smart. That doesn't help. If I say, well, gee, this is a really tough problem. What kind of ideas have you got? What have you tried? Now, I'm treating you as though you've got a brain and though you've been working at it. And pretty soon you start thinking better and figuring things out. See, you build confidence by supporting them and asking them what they think. Now, there are times when I'll make suggestions, but I'll say, you know, give me two or three possibilities, things you might do to solve this problem. Oh, I could do this, or I could do this, or I could do this. I thought, okay, occurs to me you might do this, you might do that. No, there are five. Which of those looks best to you? So you hand it back. So then they pick one. Anyone they pick, whether it was theirs or mine, doesn't matter. It's theirs because they picked it. See, that's treating them as though they have a brain. If I say, no, wait a minute, wait just a minute here. You came up with those three. They're pretty crappy. The good one was four. That was the one I, you know. Does not help. See, you can do it. Most of us, he would do it nicer than that, but we'd be doing the same thing. See, we want to help them figure it out. Then they'll feel more confident, and they'll believe, we believe they can manage it. Now, once in a great while, someone will be so depressed, or I've had a couple people who've been so angry that they're really ready to kill somebody, and I mean seriously. You know, there are times you need to take over somebody's life, but they're very rare. Mostly, we need to help them figure it out. Okay. Questions about that so far?
Well, I have a question.
Okay.
Not necessarily about just what you just now said, but how when a person's body language and their flame shooting out of their eyes and whatever,
yeah,
make it obvious to anyone with half a brain even that they're really angry, and you ask them or say something, well, why are you angry, or whatever, and they deny that they're angry.
Yeah.
And either they're in total denial, deliberately denying, or else they have not a clue of,
yeah,
what their emotions are.
Yeah.
In any way. They're so maybe emotionally dead,
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah.
I say.
Yeah, so how do you deal with a person who is angry and doesn't know it? Either doesn't know it or won't admit it, one or the other.
Exactly.
Okay. Okay. Part of it is you don't say, why are you angry? Because that's an accusation. You are something bad. You know, and for them to answer that, that's not a good position. We'll, later on, we're going to get rid of why out of your vocabulary. The second thing is, if I can acknowledge your anger, say, you know, it may not look to you as though you're angry, but it does look to me as... And we sometimes have to find words. Some people can't handle the word angry. You know, they've learned growing up that good people, nice people, Christians, are not angry. That's on the bad list. Okay. So if they do recognize, they can't admit it or can't recognize it. See, they've learned, I'm not angry. See, they're the only ones in the neighborhood who don't know it. Okay. So you may not be angry, you know, but it looks like you're a little bit bothered about this. You know, it's kind of got you a little tight and on edge or something, you know. You know, let's kind of look at what's going on with that, you know. See, there's some ways to kind of work around that. And we'll play quite a little bit more with it before we get the evenings out. So hang in there. Question was back over here somewhere. Yes?
I was just going to ask, what's a kind of, and I know this could be like a very big wide range, but so if someone's emotionally, you know, just full.
Yeah.
Okay. Even though they let off some steam, but really, you know,
yeah,
all of that crap from from childhood never really goes away. No matter how much they,
yeah,
talk about it, they still have, you know,
yeah,
judgment or resentment on account of it, and then it never really dissipates.
Yeah.
I mean, in your experience, have you sat there for years with the same person and the same crap? And
two or three options. One is, you know, think of walking pneumonia. That's people who are sick but not quite sick enough to stay home from work. Some people have walking flat brains. You know, they just always got them. You know, in my family, my mother used to say, you know, that person's on the peck. You know, it's just, you know, I mean, there's something going on. They're just, you know, it's like their underwear is too tight all the time, you know. And they're always looking for trouble. You know, they just know they're going to get it, and they create a lot of it. So there's some people who just always got that stuff going on. Probably if you work with that quite a while, there's a point where you don't want to work with that anymore. You know, go find somebody else to deal with. You know, or do a serious listening job where you say, you know, I am really concerned about you. I'm uncomfortable because I feel under attack a lot, and you seem angry all the time. I'd like to get to the bottom of that, get that dealt with. See, to be straight about it, You know, if we can't sit down and do that, or you can't do it with a counselor, see, then I'm finding another way to deal with life, see, somewhere else. You know, see, yeah, those are tough. But it could be that you could, if you listen more seriously and let them know you wanted to really deal with that, you know, and every time it comes up, call them on it. And I don't mean by saying, well, you're angry again. See, that's going to make it worse. See, it's when they do it. One of the techniques in the book that we'll talk about a little later is I call the bullfighter technique. See, it's the bull is coming at you. You know, the horns are out there. The back is up. You know, it's going to get you. See, grabbing the bull by the horns means either you got to break the bull's neck or you're going to get gored. See, this is not, those are not cool options. See, the bullfighter figured it out. It's like, oh my God, are you angry? Whoo! And let them go by. Yeah, I am. You know, and they come and then they charge again. See, and you say, oh, this you're still upset. Then they say, you took that darn listening class. You know, you've been awful ever since. Yeah, I took the listening class. You know. See, you just keep acknowledging it, and eventually they wear down. And then they go, see, in the bull ring, the bull finally would go, and sit down. You know, he would have gotten over being afraid of the crowd, but in order to get the bull angry, some guy on a jackass on the horse comes along and sticks it with a, you know, in the rump with a poker to hurt it again. See, but see, in real life, there aren't people going around doing that to the bull. So if you do that well enough, but you're really... See, mostly when somebody's angry, we don't step up to it. We don't say, oh my God, you're really angry with me. See, we say, how can we handle this, you know? See, we're not talking about the thing that's bothering us. See, sometimes you need to confront it more directly, but in a, oh, so you're angry. See, not a taking it on, but a letting it go by. So they expend that energy. That's a possibility. And it may be they've just got walking flat brains. Okay, we got to move here. Okay, now this is FB, that's for flat brain. And this guy over here is Thud. And that's because this is the person you run into. See, this is the person you're going to listen to or counsel. See, and you, it could be your spouse, friend, employer, employee, whoever it happens to be, person you're visiting because of the ministry thing, and you run into them and they say something like, you're late for dinner. Wham, right there. That starts to expand your emotional system. And the normal response to that is to have it jolt your brain, the brain to go flat, and you to defend yourself and say, I was working. Remember, that's a thought by itself. That's not an emotion. Thoughts are debatable. They're in the courtroom. And what do you get back? See, that does not help this person's overload down here. That jolts their brain again, and they come back and say, that's the excuse you always use. Wham. Somebody has got to make a living. We had a deal. I'd stay home with the kids, and you would bring home the paycheck. Boy, have you taken that to an extreme. You know, you are never home on time. If dinner were worth eating, you know, you're just like your father. Speaking of relatives, I can see you've all seen your neighbors do that. See, they start over such dang little things. But see, in between countries, that's called escalation. I like to call it the flat brain tango. You know, see, we get into this flat brain pattern, okay? Now, let's look at how to get out of that. And that can go, I mean, any topic, we can get into that. And then usually, see, you unload all the stuff you've been saving, you were nice before and kept it in, you know, it all gets dumped in there. Okay, now let's look at an alternative. So when I get hit here, I call that the thud feeling, is when somebody, like I run into somebody in the street back when I was in the pastor, and they'd say, you didn't come see me when I was in the hospital. Ah, right here. Now, that was when what I wanted to say was, you know, when I got ordained, they did not provide me with a crystal ball. Nobody told me you were there. See, notice, see the hands? See, nobody told me you were there. You didn't let me know you were going. How come you're bitching at me because I didn't do what I didn't even know about? You know? Now, isn't that rational? See, that's legal. I got a right to defend myself in this country, right? Only if somebody comes at me with a baseball bat. For me. You may think differently, but for me, only then. In relationships, if I defend myself, what I'm doing is attacking you. See? Defense and attack are identical. There's no difference. In a war, if they throw napalm on you or you throw it on them, is there any difference? Is there any difference in bombs dropped, in guns fired? See, whether you're attacking or defending does the same destruction and damage. So in a relationship, if you attack me and I defend myself, what I'm doing is attacking you. That does not improve it. Couples will ask me in counseling, what's the quickest thing I can do to improve our relationship? Now I know what it is, but I don't say. I say, well, it sounds like you're having some trouble in your relationship and you'd like it to be better. Oh yeah, we fight all the time. So you're arguing a lot. Okay. Then I've listened. Now I'm going to, that's my turn to talk. So then I say, if you want to improve your relationship really fast, stop defending yourself. But she's wrong, or he's wrong. If you want to improve your relationship, stop defending yourself. But what do I do then? Oh, that's what we're going to learn. That's what we want here, is what do you do instead of defending yourself? Okay? So when I'm hit here, what the normal thing that happens is that it goes up and jolts my brain. What you want to do is to swallow right there. You go gulp. This is really classy, high-level psychological language. You go gulp right there. You go, It helps me sometimes actually to do a big swallow right there. I say, oh, I just noticed I've been hit in the gut. How come? Do I have this coming? And then I have to think that over. See, I'm a Presbyterian. Presbyterians are serious about guilt, you know. You gotta deal with that stuff. See, am I guilty? Do I have being attacked coming? That's an important question for us to work out. I've spent a lot of time with that. And the way I've got it worked out for me is that there is only one kind of human being. We all have not done all the good stuff we might have, and we all have done some unconscious damage. And we all, on occasion, have intentionally done some damage to somebody. Now, that's the only kind of human being I know that's been done all those things. Now, that's probably with the exception of about 7 people in this room that, you know, aren't like that. But all the rest that I know are. So if you're one of those 7, you can, you know, just cross me off. But so, see, what I figure is we're all in the same boat. So what that means is I don't have it coming any more than anybody else does. I am what I think of as a basically nice person. See, basically, see, that's within reason, okay? That's, you know. So I'm a BNP, okay? And if I'm a BNP, I'm kind of wasting my time if I spend time defending myself in this situation. See, whether it's about, you know, I missed some calls. Some I just didn't get to. You know, I'm a reasonably good guy, but not altogether. So if I spend time there thinking that through while I'm dealing with this person, you know what I'm not doing? I'm not helping them. See, my job, see, as a Christian, is to help them. See, it's not to spend time thinking, oh, God, am I bad or good or how good or how bad, you know. Santa Claus checks the list, you know, am I, how far down the ladder am I, you know. Waste of time. My job is to help them. So what I need to do is say, okay, I'm a BNP, so I don't have this coming any more than anybody else does. So how come I got hit? Oh, I know. It's because there's a guy here with eyes that don't see well. See, with a flat brain, and he can't see that I'm a friend, or she can't see that I'm a friend, see, because she's got this flat brain. Now, why has she got the flat brain? Oh, I remember. It's because of the fat belly. See, that guy who jumped me about not calling on him in the hospital, see, was hurt and angry. and felt alone and sad and let down by a friend. See, he felt crappy. If I had explained all that good stuff about why I didn't know he wasn't there, would not have helped that. So my job then is to say, I've been hit here. Say, you sound really upset with me for not coming to see you in the hospital. Oh, yeah. Well, you didn't. It's your job as a pastor. You figure that that's my job and that's the stuff I should know about and I should have been there, right? And he says, absolutely right. See, we're getting clear about what the guy thinks. Okay. Oh, and since you figure that's really absolutely right and what I should have done, you're pretty disappointed with me and, in fact, irritated and angry. Oh, yeah, I really am. Now he's less than he was. So what happened? How come you were in the hospital? So we talked that over. And what were your fears and worries about that? And what was it you wanted to talk to me about? You know, what are those thoughts you have? See, we move back and forth, head, stomach, like that. He calms down. He thinks straighter. I haven't put him down. I haven't solved his problem. I haven't any of that. I've acted as a friend and supported him, and he ends up more confident and okay with who he is. Calms down. Friendship returns.
But you haven't apologized to him.
Right.
But he'll stay angry about that.
Nope.
You don't sound like you mean that.
Nope.
He'll accept it.
I don't think so. No, I think listening to him is much more powerful than an apology. See, now, I might apologize, but the problem with apologies is they come too quick. See, usually the apology is not for him. Let's say you're the guy with a heart attack.
Maybe it is for him. Maybe that would quiet him down right away.
No. Let me describe why I don't think so. See, if you've had the heart attack, see, you're upset and angry with me, okay? If you start in and I say, oh, you're right, I'm wrong, I should have been there, I am absolutely wrong, I apologize, wash my hands, pushing you away, you didn't get the stuff out of your system. You'd still have that buildup. See, people don't want apologies too quick. Apologies are usually to protect me more than they are to help you. See, if I do it right away, I'm just trying to get off the hook. No, you're absolutely right, I didn't. And that's because we hadn't gotten there yet. See, because what I was doing was listening. And listening and talking are not the same. See, we're going to make that point really clear as we go on. See, when it's the listening or counseling function is for Thud here to focus on this person. And what's going on in this person, and to deal with that, and to stay with that. Once we've done that, then in effect we switch, and then it's my turn to talk. And that's where I would apologize. But see, usually the apologies come too quick, and they're not effective. And it's because I should be listening, and the person's still upset with me. When I've really listened long enough and they've calmed down, then some very interesting things happen. If this person really calms down, then their brain stretches out, then their ears start to work, and they see me as a friend. See, that stuff starts to work again. Then they can hear an apology. Then they can see that I'm a friend. I can't tell you how many times with couples, there'll be a kind of a traditional screw up that the husband does something that, you know, blows the wife or something, and so she says, "Well, you did it again. Oh, right, I apologize." But she's not done being angry. See, she's still loaded up. We got to get that unloaded first. Then the apology makes some sense. But it's when it's his turn to talk. And usually we do that too quick. Hang on, we'll get there more as we go along, and I think it'll make more sense. It really is not the way we're used to thinking about it. See, I'm not presenting what you would have run across other places. But I'll get to that. Yeah.
It's kind of twofold. Is under this definition of don't defend yourself.
Yeah.
Is explain yourself just a synonymous way of defending yourself?
Yes.
What are some other ways that if you're kind of clever like myself or tricky myself, and I say, I'm really not defending myself, I'm just explaining.
Right.
What are some other faces that defending takes?
Oh, other ways of defending. Yeah, one is explaining, that's defending. Another is going after the credibility of the person. I mean, you never went to college, you don't know about that, or you're not checked out in this area, or you know, with your background and your relatives, or you're really a psychoceramic, you know, you're a crackpot, you, whatever your background things are. You know, I mean, there are lots of ways we can damage a person. But see, all of them are talking, not listening. See, what I'm really after here is to clarify the difference between what we normally do. See, normal behavior is defense of some sort. That's normal. That's what we've learned. Think of the courtrooms. Think of what we watch on television. You can't turn television on without courtroom shows. It's attack and defend, dodge and weave, you know, all of this stuff. It's the way we've learned. Somebody says, you know, goes outside on a sunny day and says, look at that sunshine, it's beautiful. Other person says, yeah, but I can see a cloud right over there. See, we argue and defend and rationalize so fast, it is so much a part of us that we don't even think about it. See, you know, if somebody says the sky's blue, somebody says, no, it's gray, you know, just that fast. And see, what I'm after is to learn to recognize that we do that so we stop doing it. And so instead of that then, instead of defending myself, what I do is I say, oh, I'm going to focus on this person. And I'm going to listen to this one, understand how upset they are, how they think about it, what they see their eyes, what they heard, you know, how they're feeling, all of that. I'm going to stay with that. And that's going to help them get through it.
So not to belabor this too much, so what I heard you say was defending yourself can be an aggressive act going at that person.
Yes.
Or it can be sort of more passive, where you're making excuses, you're explaining.
Yeah. Here, watch this great way to defend myself. You're on my case, watch this. See, oh, or, see? I tune you out. See, I just treat you as though you don't exist, you don't matter. Paper, computer, see? There are lots of ways to treat people as though they don't matter, all of which are defending ourselves and attacking them, all of which make the relationship worse. See, what I'm after is a different way than that. Okay? Yeah. Yeah.
Having been there.
Uh-huh.
Even if I demand it, I don't want it. Until
yeah.
I felt heard.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, because I'm as manipulative as you might be in wanting to not be wrong, I, having worked with him, he'll bounce it back.
Yeah.
Jim will not parlay with me until he has a sensing that I am not flat brained, and then I will hear whatever is being presented. Does that make sense? So I could very well be clear about what it is I'm wanting, but if I'm obviously clear to the casual observer that I'm flat-brained, he won't play. It's really frustrating.
Yeah, I'd probably say something like, you really would like to have an apology here because you're really angry with me. See, and did you notice your head nod when I said that?
Right.
See, that's what you watch for when you're listening. See, that I call that a communication loop. See, she said something, you know, I'm so angry, I want an apology right now, even if that's not what's going to work. See, and I said, oh, so you want an apology right now. See your head nod like that? It just keeps going. See, you know, if you don't say, I understand, because that does no good. That puts them off. See, I understand always has these hand motions, like this, pushes away. I'd like you to write that down. Just never say, I understand again. Never. What?
What do you say if you don't say, I understand?
Okay, see, your question is, what do you say? That means talk. What I'm suggesting is what you do is you listen.
Okay.
I didn't have to tell her I understood because I fed it back and she went, uh-huh, like that. That means she knew I understood.
So if I sit quietly and don't say anything but just keep looking at them, then they know they're being understood?
Not necessarily, no.
Okay.
No. No, you need to use some words. But the words focus on what's in the other person, not what's in you. See, I understand is in me. You know, when somebody's just gotten cancer, you know, the friends go, oh, I understand, dear. You know, and they say, the hell you do. I've worked with grief groups, you know, people have had major losses. And one of the things that bothers them the most are their friends who say they understand, because that is so, so unaware.
You know? What if you've been through it too, though?
You haven't been through theirs. See? See, you've been through yours, but yours and theirs may be very different. See, the idea is, see, one of the things is that our experience sometimes gets in the way. See, if you've been through cancer, you know, oh dear, I understand because I've been through it, you know. See, what you've just done is started to talk. See, you want to tell your story then. That's what most lay people do when they go into hospital rooms. They go in to tell their story about the friends they know that died of this, you know. You know, or that, or of their friends who had the same problem and had the, but they need to get the right doctor, you know. See, instead you go in and say, oh, what's going on with you? So you want to listen to that. See, most of us are more interested in ourselves and our own stories than in anybody else's. See, here's a, for me, a theological issue. I think we're sinful people. See, sinful people really simply means I'm just a hell of a lot more interested in me than I am in you. You know, that's the truth. Let's just get to it. Okay? Now, when I understand that, that allows me to catch myself when I start doing that and say, oh, well, wait, now, wait a minute, John, what were you saying about that? Or about this cancer thing you're going through. Yeah, yeah, I've been through some myself, but it's not yours. What's yours like? See, that's getting into your life, and a listener does that. See, and so whether if it happens to be because, you know, I hurt you and you're hurt and angry and want an apology, I say, okay, so you're hurt and angry and want an apology. You know, what is it that I, what is it about what I said that got to you that much, you know? This apparently was really painful for you. See, for me to get into yours and walk with you in that and understand it, so when we're in yours, you're not alone in it, but I'm with you in it. But if I say, oh, I understand, it just pushes you away. Now, lots of us say that because we don't want to hurt. You know, if I go in a hospital room and somebody's dying of old age, you know, I don't want to listen to that, you know, because I'm maybe 3 years older than they are. And it's kind of like they're meddling with stuff, you know? And that's not fun. I don't want that. If you don't want to be in pain with people, don't be a listener. See, just stay with your own stuff and stay apart from people. If you're willing to be in pain and you want to support people in their lives, then go ahead and listen, and it's going to be some pain. But there are going to be rich rewards, because you'll walk away from some of those situations feeling like you've been in their lives and you've been blessed, you know. And, you know, that's a wonderful thing and a difficult thing. I think we're going to take it. Yeah.
Is there a danger of becoming holier than thou? That is, you as a good listener, or an excellent listener, the other person might feel that you're just too good. You can't possibly be that good. There's no way I can match you.
Yeah. Have you ever found me that good? I haven't.
Not recently.
Not recently. Yeah. Well, I've kind of lost my touch as I got older.
When you're being a bullfighter.
I don't think so. Yeah.
When you're being a bullfighter.
Yeah.
Isn't your stomach getting bigger and bigger? You know,
Good question. Yeah. Yeah. When we listen a lot, we have to have our own times to unload. See, and notice I've been talking about we as a group, we're a listener. I've been talking about that. I haven't talked yet about when it's our turn to talk. See, there are times when we need to talk and get our stuff out. After we take a break, we're going to get to a taking turns process, so that with the folks, you know, when I've listened to the other person for a while and kind of let them get theirs out, then there will come a time when it's their time to listen to me, and I have a chance to get mine out. And